Yesterday, the Surgeon General released a report on indoor smoking. This report is a reminder that tobacco remains the number one cause of preventable death in the United States today. I am Allan Noonan, the Dean of the School of Public Health and Policy here at Morgan State University in Baltimore, Maryland, and we are broadcasting from the Carl J. Murphy Fine Arts Center. We're here today to talk about smoking and tobacco use among students in historically black colleges and universities. College students are a key population in efforts to understand and control the epidemic of tobacco. As many as a third of any population of college students are smokers, and 20% of them, or 20% of students, begin smoking while they are in college. These young people are our country's future. They are our future educators, our healthcare professionals, opinion leaders, corporate leaders, and policymakers. So college students' knowledge of and attitudes towards tobacco are key factors in tomorrow's education about tobacco, the support we will give to people in the future to cease smoking and to develop a national policy around tobacco. What is known about college-age African-American smokers comes primarily from surveys of the general college-age population. The good news from these sources is that the rates of smoking and use of other tobacco products are comparatively low among African-American college students. But we have to ask the question, will these students, when they graduate, continue to be non-smokers? Will they help develop effective policies that will keep or that will make our country smoking free? Approximately 300,000 students, some 13% of all black students enrolled in a college or university, attend a historically black college or university, an HBCU. Yet, we know very little about the smoking behaviors of these students. Today's topic will be tobacco use prevention initiatives at historically black colleges and universities, the on-the-ground smoking cessation and prevention project. Morgan State University was founded in 1867 by the Baltimore Conference of the Methodist Episcopal Church. The original mission was to train young men for the ministry. Today, more than 6,000 men and women are enrolled here at Morgan as undergraduates in master's programs and in doctoral programs in a wide variety of fields. Morgan's State University awards more bachelor's degrees to African Americans than any other campus in Maryland. And in fact, if you look at many scientific fields or many professional fields, Morgan graduates a significant number of the African-American graduates, especially in engineering and the sciences. Though a historically black institution, Morgan serves students of all racial and ethnic backgrounds. Its mission today is to provide a full range of academic experiences and services to help a socioeconomically diverse student body achieve its goals. Seeking to meet the public health needs of the underserved populations, our School of Public Health and Policy at Morgan has graduated 56 professionals in the past 5 years from our accredited public health training program. But we are also, our school is composed not only of our public health training program, but also of our undergraduate nutrition program and our Prevention Sciences Research Center, which is nationally known for its research in strategies to improve the health of our most needy communities. I have the honor of moderating our discussion today, focusing on tobacco use in African-American college students. About 22% of all African-Americans smoke cigarettes. We tend to initiate smoking later than other racial and ethnic groups, and African-American adolescents have a lower smoking rate than white adolescents. But because smoking rates for African-Americans continue to increase into adulthood, and African-American smokers are slower to quit, smoking rates among African-American adults are almost double those of white adults. Even though African-American smokers on average smoke fewer cigarettes per day than white smokers, African-Americans appear to be more susceptible to developing smoking-related illnesses. Each year, 45,000 African-Americans die from smoking-related preventable illnesses. Given the limited information available on smoking among students attending HBCUs, the American Legacy Foundation is funding a very important initiative. It's called the On the Ground Smoking Cessation and Prevention Project. This effort has brought together an interdisciplinary collaborative of three universities in North Carolina, Bennett College, North Carolina A&T State University, and North Carolina Central University. We are pleased to have with us four prime movers in the Legacy Foundation project to discuss the issues of tobacco use and prevention on our campuses. Let us meet our panel. First, Ms. Michelle Cotton-Laws is a PhD candidate in the Department of Sociology and Anthropology at North Carolina State University. She is a researcher, an American Legacy Foundation project evaluator and trainer, and an instructor in sociology at the college level. Ms. Cotton-Laws has served as legislative liaison for the North Carolina Division of Mental Health, as substance abuse and policy consultant in the North Carolina Governor's Office, and on the Governor's Commission on Juvenile Crime and Juvenile Justice. Her current research focuses on tobacco use and related behaviors among students attending HBCUs. Next, Ms. Sharon Fryar Height is studying toward an MS degree in adult education with a minor in higher education, and she is at North Carolina Agriculture and Technical State University in Greensboro. She received her Bachelor of Arts degree from Bennett College, where she now serves as the project director for the Bennett College On the Ground Smoking Cessation and Prevention Project, which has successfully engaged women throughout the greater Greensboro area in meaningful action and discussion around the dangers of tobacco use. A native of North Carolina, Ms. Height is from a region known for its private and commercial tobacco farms and is frequently referred to as Tobacco Road. Also with us, we have Ms. Adrienne Witherspoon, who serves as a tobacco project coordinator at North Carolina A&T University's School of Nursing. She's a fundraiser, a social justice advocate, and a nonprofit manager. Through her professional pursuits and civic involvement, Ms. Witherspoon has worked for social justice and equality at the local, state, national, and international levels. Her career achievements include focusing on literacy, domestic violence, early childhood education, and community leadership development. She was a delegate in 1995 from North Carolina to the United Nations Fourth World Conference on Women in Beijing, China. And our discussant for all of this knowledge that we're going to enjoy today is Dr. Helen Lettlow. Dr. Lettlow is Associate Vice President for Program Development for Priority Populations at the American Legacy Foundation, where she spearheads the foundation's strategies to address health disparities, to develop new pilot projects, to conduct outreach to national leadership groups, and to collaborate with the many stakeholders who are involved in the tobacco effort. Dr. Lettlow received her doctorate in public health from Columbia University's Mailman School of Public Health, and has more than 20 years of professional experience in tobacco control, not only tobacco control, women's health. We first met when she was working in HIV/AIDS, and she's also done a lot of work in minority health. From 1996 to 1999, Dr. Lettlow served as the director of Women's Health at the American Social Health Association, where she directed a research demonstration project aimed at preventing cervical cancer among African American and Hispanic women in North Carolina. She has also served as a program chair for the Reproductive Health section of the American Public Health Association. Please welcome me in joining our, help join me in welcoming our panel. During the first part of today's broadcast, our panel members will share their work in tobacco use prevention at three historically black colleges. We will then give our studio audience and our broadcast audience an opportunity to participate in the discussion. The phone number to be called is 1-877-869-7811. Or you can get your comments and questions to us through email. Send your email to questions, that's Q-U-E-S-T-I-O-N-S, at unc.edu. The telephone number and email addresses will appear periodically through the broadcast. Our first presenter is Ms. Michelle Cotton-Laws, who will speak on the prevalence, patterns, and norms of tobacco use among students at HBCUs. Ms. Laws.
Thank you, Dr. Noonan, and thank you also, Dr. Dorothy Brown and Dr. Victor Schoenbach, and all of the staff and students at Morgan State University and at UNC Chapel Hill School of Public Health for the vision to sponsor such a timely and necessary conference. And I would also be remiss if I didn't seize the opportunity to also thank Ms. Amber Thornton and Dr. Helen Lettlow and Robin Scott with the American Legacy Foundation for their financial backing and commitment to ensure that much needed funds are made available to minority serving institutions for research and programming to help further our work on reducing tobacco use and its related consequences, and of course to the viewers and participants. I am here today to present on just one component of the North Carolina on the ground cessation project. This project was spearheaded in North Carolina and carried out under the outstanding leadership of Mr. Al Richmond with the North Carolina Institute for Minority Economic Development, and he is here today in the audience. Mr. Richmond and the Institute's director, Ms. Andrea Harris, understand clearly the link between economic disparities and health disparities and their related outcomes. The goal of the North Carolina on the ground cessation project is to reduce smoking among college students attending HBCUs, to strengthen anti-smoking policies on campuses, and raise public awareness about the harmful effects of tobacco use on the campuses of HBCUs and in the surrounding communities. The principal partners of the On the Ground project are the North Carolina Institute for Minority Economic Development, North Carolina Central University, specifically the leadership of Dr. Nan Coleman with the Historically Minority Colleges and Universities Consortium, which is housed on the campus of NCCU, Bennett College for Women, and North Carolina A&T State University. And my colleagues, Ms. Sharon Fryar Height and Ms. Adrienne Witherspoon, will follow me to present on the impressive and invaluable work that they have accomplished as project partners. I do want to just go over the lay of the land a bit in North Carolina. There are 11 HBCUs, five private, five public, and six private in North Carolina with a combined enrollment of about 30,000 students. Now, typically, we know that HBCUs are located in the heart of low-wealth communities. Historically, HBCUs have been the focal point of cultural, social, political, economic, and health activities in black communities. This project has allowed us to use our influence and positioning in these communities to come together to address minority health issues. The part that I'm excited about to be able to share is the research component of the On the Ground Cessation Project in North Carolina. Let's start with what we already know. National research findings indicate that cigarette smoking rates declined between 1993 and 2000 among all U.S. adults, except those aged 18 to 24 years of age. Reports of college students' tobacco use range from approximately 27% to 34%, and we can find that in the supported in the literature. 10 to 20% of college students initiate smoking or become regular smokers while they are in college. We also know that in 2004, African Americans made up approximately 12% of the college student population, and we're speaking specifically four-year institutions. Among African American college students, the rates of smoking and using other tobacco products were comparatively low, as Dr. Noonan pointed out, in the range of about 4% to 9%. The preponderance of prior research has been conducted in predominantly non-minority college settings, with inferences drawn from the general college population. There has been minimal evidence to support considerations of cultural and linguistically diverse populations and competency in these prior research findings. Very little is known about the prevalence, social norms, and patterns of smoking among students attending HBCUs, which is why we feel that our research and work through the project has been invaluable in adding another level of information that has not been found or that was, we would say, scarce in the current or prior literature. The current study investigates the prevalence, patterns, and norms associated with tobacco use among college students attending HBCUs in North Carolina. Our method, basically, our sample included a random sample of about 2,533 undergraduate college students at 9 HBCUs. It was a cross-sectional, self-administered survey, and the questionnaire was designed using or pulling from other nationally used instruments, including the CDC's National Youth Tobacco Survey, the Global Youth Tobacco Survey, and State and Local Youth Risk Behavior Survey. We field tested our instrument during the summer and fall of 2004, and then administered the survey to the participating colleges and universities during the school sessions between 2005-06 and 2004-05 school academic years. I'm going to report on waves one and two, which include Bennett College for Women, Elizabeth City State, Livingstone, North Carolina Central, Shaw University, and Winston-Salem State. We had not completed our cleaning of the wave three data, and so I pulled that, and we will report on our findings from waves one and two today. Basically, what we found is our demographics within our sample was a true representation of the population, the students attending HBCUs. Approximately 84.6% were African Americans, followed by about 16% that were other among the race in terms of race and ethnicity. Also gender, approximately 71% were female and 29% male. Our age populations represented again what we expected to find. Our sample represented again what we expected to find and expect to find in the general HBCU college population, approximately 88% are between the ages of 18 and 24. And then surprisingly, there is this misperception that a lot of students attending HBCUs come from single-parent homes. We did not find that to be the case. Actually, we found strong evidence to show that about 49%, the majority of the students at these HBCUs actually come from two-parent backgrounds or families, followed by about 42% from single parents and 10% from other types of family situations, including foster care or coming from some type of institutional settings, group homes, and so forth and so on. In terms of academic classification, 35% freshmen, followed by about 30% sophomores, so about 65% between within the freshman and sophomore academic classification, and then about 20% were juniors, followed by 14% who were identified as seniors. Now, the findings relevant to our discussion today on tobacco use. What we found was that 14% of our sample were identified as current smokers, and we used basically the same definition of current smoker that is used in, again, most of the standardized or national survey instruments. And we found, as you can, the data show that a large percentage of our students at these, within our sample at these universities were not smokers. Blacks were less likely to be smokers than those who identified themselves as the other race group. And males were more likely than females to be current smokers. Now, this should not be shocking information. This wasn't groundbreaking discoveries. This basically support much of what was in the existing research literature. About 58% of the smokers reported that they smoked under the age of 18 compared to 25% of the non-smokers. And among the smokers, about 39.2% reported that neither of their parents smoked, compared to 54% of those who identified themselves as non-smokers. The majority of the students also, when we looked at whether or not smoking was something that was encouraged, is it cool to smoke? Is it encouraged? Is it something that is received well or with disdain? So we wanted to look and explore social norms. What are the attitudes about smoking? Is it kind of, you know, whatever? Or is there this rejection among this population towards smoking? The majority of the students overall, 83.6%, about 84%, responded that smoking was actually discouraged. So it was not a part of the social culture. It was not a widely accepted in practice, nor, as we saw, practice habit or behavior. Among the smokers and non-smokers, about 86.2% of the non-smokers compared to about 67.4% of the smokers stated or responded that smoking was discouraged. And then we also looked at whether or not they preferred, in terms of peer association, again, working with what we already knew. We looked at whether or not there was a preference towards associating with people who smoked versus those who did not. And we found, as the data show, that 8.9% of smokers reported that they prefer associating with peers who smoke compared to less than 1% of the non-smokers. And then in terms of whether or not you prefer to associate versus whether or not you have friends who smoke. We know that students come in from all different backgrounds and all different places and spaces, I say. And so you may not prefer to smoke, but you may have friends who do smoke. And so we asked that question as well. And what we found was that among the smokers, 13.9% of smokers compared to 43.8% of the smokers reported that none of their closest friends smoke. So a negative association between the two there. Reasons for smoking. Why, among those who smoked, why are you smoking? And the three leading reasons that were identified among our sample are, one, I like the sensation, two, don't really know, and then three, some other reason. We did find that there was a significant, statistically significant difference in terms of race and ethnicity for reasons of smoke. And African Americans, we found like the sensation, but when we looked at whites and those in the other category, ethnic categories, they identified habit that they couldn't control, followed by like the sensation. I'm going to go quickly because I was just given a time signal here, but I will entertain any further questions. other factors that we looked at was gender and depression, as well as peer influences. And this certainly, again, supports some of the previous studies, specifically Wang, Brown, and Wagner, that was conducted here at Morgan State. And they found that there was a strong correlation between depression and tobacco use. And we'll talk a little bit more about what that actually means. And the depression scale was created using a revised version of CESD. Cessation, what about quitting? The leading reasons given by smokers for not being able to stop smoking: strong cravings, feelings of irritability, peer influence, and that they lack the support. We asked in the past 12 months, what ways did you seek stopping? And this is very important because this showed something different than what has been pushed previously in terms of strong, effective cessation. For example, the quit line has been heralded as an effective and cost-effective way. But what we found is that many of our students, they sought information from the website or attended smoking cessation or health education programs or used medicines. A small percentage used or called the quit helpline, but what's particularly of interest here are the perceived benefits or programs that are perceived beneficial. And if you'll see, the top three are self-help, peer support, and school-based programs. This certainly supports the work of the other two projects that are included or that are part of this on-the-ground cessation project that you will hear about from my colleagues. So self-help, peer support, and school-based programs. And interventions that are being used are school-based policies and environmental control strategies. And we've heard about those: smoke-free areas on campuses and in dorms, limited tobacco advertising, and increased awareness about and participation in anti-smoking campaigns. There is still much work that needs to be done. We still need to look at some of these other emerging health issues, depression and its link. We need to, I think, examine further also some of the psychosocial needs and responses to smoking, and further investigate in the use of prevalence of other substances, particularly marijuana. We have just actually revised the survey and re-administered it at North Carolina Central University, testing the revised version of it, where we've added a marijuana question. If they're not smoking tobacco, are they using other substances, smoking other substances? And if so, is there any type of correlation or association? We need to continue to look at and evaluate prevention and intervention programs to determine their effectiveness. And this includes also in the research piece, conducting longitudinal studies to indeed look at rates and changes. My concluding points, recommendations for conducting future research is: one, to avoid operating under the notion that we find what we look for and we look for that which we know. There is no one-size model that fits all. When we know, when we're looking at minority populations, we have to consider cultural characteristics and experiences of all populations that we serve and seek to better understand in our effort to develop intervention programs to address health issues and needs. I will stop there and entertain any questions that you have at a later time. Thank you.
Good afternoon, and I extend a hearty greeting to you all from Greensboro, North Carolina, Bennett College for Women, On the Ground Smoking Cessation and Prevention Project. The Bennett College for Women, On the Ground Smoking Cessation and Prevention Project developed its program around four basic principles, which is to educate, to engage, inspire, to create productive change. Over the course of a few years, Bennett College for Women have not had the privilege, until the American Legacy Foundation made funds available to support the on-the-ground smoking cessation and prevention project, to address health issues such as tobacco usage, tobacco exposure, and also tobacco awareness. The first thing with our four prongs, which is the educate, engage, inspire to create change. Educate first peer health advocates, which are the Bennett College for Women students ranging from age 18 until 22. Educate peer health advocates concerning issues as it relates to tobacco use. And then engage peer health advocates in conversations with each other concerning tobacco use and also some of their own collegiate experiences. And then inspire the peer health advocates to take information that has been taught to them, coupled with their own experiences as students, to go out into the Bennett College community and ultimately the world to create meaningful and positive change. Bennett College for Women, 14th President Dr. Janetta B. Cole, gave the following charge to the On the Ground Smoking Cessation Project. You cannot lead where you will not go. The college, again, had not in years prior to receiving this grant strategically addressed issues that related to tobacco use, exposure, awareness, and cessation. First of all, let's ask this question. How do you spark interest among college students in a project that is entirely dedicated to the eradication of tobacco usage everywhere, average college students? You start by starting the conversation. Out of doing something that most women love to do, which is talking, the Sister Chat program began. These chats began first with peer health advocates exchanging experiences with each other during weekly meetings, and the chats moved to residence parlors among the peer health advocates and Bennett College women whom resided on campus. The Sister Chat program grew not only to include women of Bennett College who lived on campus, but also students who lived off campus, and then later to emerge with faculty, staff, and community leaders and guests of the college. Peer health advocates saw the project as a means of not just work, although they were reimbursed for $8 an hour for their time. They saw this as a means of creating social change. One peer health advocate, Florence Dennett, stated that she took this project personally, and tobacco industries were heavily targeting youth and minorities at alarming rates, yet those who were being targeted the most stood idly by and did nothing. Peer health advocates wanted to do more than fulfill the goals of the project, which were to educate at least 10 students in tobacco prevention, and also to have a reduction in tobacco use among the college community by 25% over a period of 6 months. They wanted to create change on the campus of Bennett College for Women that would be lasting now and in the future. What did they do? They took their message to the Greensboro community. In order to be totally effective, it's imperative that the project knew its audience and the population in which it served. Bennett College is one of two historically black colleges for women. The current enrollment is 600 students, 600 women, who represent all 50 states and several foreign countries. Out of the 600 women, Bennett slightly represents over about 10%, which belong to Greek letter organizations. Greek life is a major contributor to the social benefits of attending Bennett College for Women. Increasingly enough, peer health advocates wanted to take full advantage of the affluence that the Greek organizations had with Bennett students. They began holding their sister chats with Bennett students and their sister chats with sorority members. Co-hosting informational sessions with the Greeks, this partnership began to create a buzz and around campus about the project, about what we were doing. When one sorority heard that we had a presentation with another sorority, immediately other sororities wanted to be a part of the conversation and find out ways in which they could join the movement. The Omicron Delta chapter of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated, with the aid of the On the Ground Project, wanted to agree to make sister chats a standing program within their community and sorority chapter. They agreed to have permanent tobacco awareness programs every semester to help bring about meaningful change. While it is important to have sister chats among their peers and Greensboro community, the project felt it would be most beneficial to stand in solidarity with like-minded international individuals to join in this fight, this movement against the tobacco industry. But equally important, against passivity, which is when it came to what tobacco was doing in our community. Dr. M. Joycelyn Elders, former United States Surgeon General, agreed to speak at Bennett College for Women about awareness concerning the usage and exposure of tobacco products. Her message was one of information and hope. Dr. Elders shared that while African Americans tended to begin smoking later in life, they more than made up for the tobacco usage at startup in a manner that only she can. Dr. Elders charged the students and all that were in attendance to be mindful of the vices that would easily beset them. And that there were health ramifications that could and ultimately would cost them their lives. This next slide, the point of sale slide, is talking about the project, and again, the point of sale component of the project was to address the disparity in advertising tobacco elimination. The point of sale component of the project was to address the disparity in tobacco advertisement and the elimination of the disparity in advertisement of tobacco products in low-wealth neighborhoods surrounding Bennett College for Women and North Carolina A&T State University. Peer health advocates conducted research between low-wealth and non-low-wealth neighborhoods. While it is not the intent of the project to determine whether stores were complying with sale of tobacco products and regulations, the peer health advocates wanted to find out if stores were selling loose cigarettes, also known as loosies. The project discovered that not two blocks away from Bennett College for Women, a store was selling loose cigarettes and did not request identification before selling the product. The store around Bennett College and North Carolina A&T State University typically have appearances such as the picture presented here. This particular store is approximately two blocks away from North Carolina A&T and 1 mile from a major tobacco manufacturer. Bennett College for Women, as a result of the on-the-ground smoking cessation and prevention project coming to Bennett College, Bennett College became 100% smoke-free. What does smoke-free mean? Smoke-free means on the campus of Bennett College that smoking of tobacco products and use of tobacco products is prohibited by everyone, everywhere, at all times. But how did this happen? The president announced that the college would go smoke-free. With the college being private and the president being the CEO or president of the college, she had the power to make that change into law. But how could a law become enforced? By creating faculty, staff, and student buy-in. What do I mean by buy-in? Buy-in in the case of Bennett College for Women meant that we had to have programs that valued the ideas, the opinions of all parties concerned. The project was not used to condemn those who chose to smoke, but to ensure that everyone that attended Bennett College or visited the campus had the right to breathe just a little bit easier. Some of the accomplishments. Partnerships were important because it made the project more effective and enhanced the movement that was created on campus and afforded us the ability to take the movement to the Greensboro community. Community relationships were vital. In order for the project to have community credibility, we had to actively support the community's functions while igniting interest in the movement that was taking place at Bennett College for Women. While it was significant to have the partnerships and the community relationships, it was imperative to have the active participation of the college administration and support of college administration. Without the support of college administration, this project would have simply been just another program, just another project. When key administrators joined the movement, they were able to somewhat assist the project with enforcement in areas that we had little or no power. For example, We could request that the Department of Public Safety would assist with enforcing the new rule of smoking being prohibited all over the campus. But with active enforcement had to come with from authority that was higher than ourselves. How could a project that had never been on the campus of Bennett College for Women be effective in the development of a student-led movement that had not only swept the Bennett College family, but the Greensboro community? The project's success is due to us having an advisory committee of diverse professionals with one common goal, of creating a world, namely an atmosphere at Bennett College for Women, where young people could reject tobacco and anyone could quit. Now, this movement, this slogan, this legacy that is now at Bennett College was a result of the American Legacy Foundation. The Dynamic Advisory Committee consisted of the Executive Vice President of the College, the Vice President of Institutional Effectiveness, the Director of Student Health Center, the Program Coordinator for the On the Ground Project from the North Carolina Institute of Minority Economic Development, Peer Health Advocate, and the Director of Counseling Services, Bennett College On the Ground Coordinator, and also the Bennett College On the Ground Assistant Coordinator. This project at Bennett College could not have been effective without the support from our funding agency and partners here at the American Legacy Foundation. From our family at Bennett College for Women to your family here at Morgan State University and abroad, we extend a hearty thank you and a congratulations on changing the world, one life, one institution at a time. Thank you.
I truly appreciate the opportunity to come here and share North Carolina A&T's approach to tobacco control and tobacco prevention at our campus. Many of you know our campus as one of the leaders in civil rights, social activism, and student-led movements against inequities. But there's another side to North Carolina A&T State University, one that a lot of African-American communities know. That is the uncertain relationship that we have with tobacco. Tobacco has done a number of things for communities. Tobacco has educated families. Tobacco has created health issues that we're now just knowing about and having to address. And tobacco money feeds some people's families. That is what we had to look at when we at North Carolina State University, North Carolina A&T State University, one of two land grant institutions in our community, decided that we were going to partner with the other institutions in the state to apply for money to look at tobacco prevention at an HBCU. And with this movement and with this understanding of our relationship and some of the issues that we were going to have to meet as challenges, that is, it not being on the radar as a priority, it not being funded because of perceptions that our School of Agriculture would have adverse effects if we took tobacco money to do prevention projects, which we found out during the course of this was erroneous. That they are one of our number one champions now. They have never received tobacco money for scholarships or research on our campus. And that our students would be resistant to working toward stopping something that we, again, did not have as a priority to my understanding at the time that we applied for this money with the other institutions. So as I talk about our project, it is part of the Underground Cessation and Prevention Tobacco Project. However, I will refer to it as STOP, Stomping Tobacco Out with Pride. And this is because the students in this project decided they wanted ownership. They wanted to reflect their Aggie pride, because that is the mantra of our university, Aggie pride. So we are stomping tobacco out with pride at North Carolina A&T State University. The objectives of the project are to produce a radio program, which we effectively did for a semester. We produced 10 weekly radio programs talking about tobacco prevention and the hazards of tobacco on our campus and in our communities, to develop students as tobacco advocates and leaders. And that's one of the things that when we embarked on this that we know that we have to do at HBCUs, that we do not have the luxury of letting students come through these institutions and not preparing them for the world, the workforce, and for the to fall in tradition of looking for the greater good in society. So not only were we preparing them to work on a project, we invested in these students to prepare them to lead not only this movement on our campus, but to go into the community and have competencies to work within the African American community on issues around disparities. And we did this through conducting campus and community research and helping and teaching the students to develop education programs. It was not a single-driven, single-focused project. I was the development director for the School of Education, had been a development director for the School of Nursing, and so coming together with these two departments and the Department of Journalism and Mass Communication, who has a media medical literacy project or major, we came together as a unit to look at how can we develop students who have a vested interest in tobacco prevention to develop a project that would be not time limited. Oftentimes, as a fundraiser, we find money that's time limited. We wanted to develop a project that was not time limited but was sustainable or income generating. So we partnered with community partners, public housing community, a human service organization, Guilford County Tobacco, Guilford County Health Department, because they already had a tobacco prevention project where they were working with the other campuses within our county, university campuses. Bennett College for Women, North Carolina Central University, and of course, the North Carolina Institute for Minority Economic Development, which partnered with us to get this grant. We wanted to develop the students. Again, first and foremost, we were engaging communities and developing students. And one of the issues that we had, and I was going to say challenges, but I decided before I came out, I was going to call everything issues. So one of the issues that we had when we were awarded the money, but we had not accepted it, was because of our relationship with the tobacco industry, which is 9/10 of a mile from our campus. We had to wait. Unlike the other institutions, there were some issues. So it took us 4 months before we could accept the money. And in that 4 months, in preparing to accept the award from the American Legacy Foundation, which came with the support of one of our legislators, who of course made it possible for money to be awarded a different way through the tobacco settlement money within our state, we had to find what is the best way, the most advantageous way of working on tobacco prevention. And so even developing a radio program, we knew that it was more strategic to start off our campus, engage the community, get buy-in from the community, get support from the community, develop good public relations attention for our campus, and then to come on our campus and work on tobacco prevention. We recruited students from the three academic units that I had spoken about earlier, but we recruited them as cohorts. How do we bring kids in to engage them in something on campus where it is supporting the academic mission of the university, but also supporting the goals of the academic units? So we, through the School of Education and Nursing and College of Arts and Sciences, we recruited 10 students who received course credit for coming through this project. In addition, with all of the students, they got $150 stipend, which is not a lot of money for what I required of them. In addition to the students that came through the cohorts, we also had students who came to the campus with some prior experience, because We were just starting on university with prevention, but there were some high school initiatives that had been taking place over the last, I think, 5 years in the community. And so we had students, and we continue to have students who come on campus with tobacco prevention experience, but they just did not have an avenue for continuing that. And again, we are grateful to the American Legacy Foundation for awarding the money to the university community. And then students found out about the project through the health department and other ways, and they came to us asking if they could be a part of it. As I was developing the project and we were recruiting students and we were recruiting faculty, I kept asking the question, what's in it for me? As we go, everybody within the university know how difficult it is for you to take on one more thing. You know, you're required to research, you publish, you work with students, you advise. One more thing, why should I do one more thing? So I tried to make it easy. And one of the things that we were able to do, because I was not faculty, I was a fundraiser, but I had worked in developing community programs in the past, was the dean assigned me to have oversight on this project, which means the students that were recruited had one more adult to mentor them, to serve in an advisory capacity, but to support them and to report back to the dean and to the faculty, so it was not one more thing for faculty to take on. So I think it made it a little more palatable to get support on campus. It supported academics because students actually were using this as projects and community service. I have been an educator. I'm certified. I've taught. So I went as an educator. I supported what the faculty wanted done with this. I reported back. I monitored and evaluated students. Service learning. All of us are required in the universities now for students to have service learning experiences. It supported that. And students, and what we found with these students, a lot of them were first-generation college students. So that gave them an extra edge, a little additional support that was not available to them before. And we trained. We trained using our campus and community partners. Again, people who we were getting buy-in from. Why should people work on tobacco control? I mean, sometimes you can say, well, I don't smoke, I'm not going to die. You know, you don't have information. It was important to us for people to have information, because in the course of this, we found out everyone has some relationship with tobacco. You know someone who's died, you know someone who's sick, you know how you feel when you have to walk through a cloud of smoke. Everyone has an opinion, and everyone we've found so far has a relationship. The training we used as an opportunity to train students long-term, not just for this project, but also to engage our community partners, to get buy-in, but to get the support we need to make this a permanent program on our campus, not just a time-limited project based on funding. And the training, with the final results were, how do we serve the community? How do we engage the community? And we engage the community through research in the community, radio broadcasts that broadcast weekly, bringing in experts, and a health festival. Again, a lot of this was student-driven. Radio productions, it's fun to get on radio. Every week, to get on the radio, have different people to come in and to hear yourself. Students loved it. We trained students, nursing students, to host a radio program. Research, we had sophomore and junior year students to learn to conduct academic research and learn to use SPSS. They surveyed the campus community, they surveyed the public housing community, and they compared. Again, helping them develop competencies to work in the community. I think some people think that they know how to work with any group of people just because you're the same race. We had to work with our kids to understand. And I'm saying kids because I probably taught some of their parents when they were in elementary school. So students. Some of our students came to us feeling that they knew they were prepared to go in communities. They were afraid to go into the public housing community. They had perceptions about the public housing community that could have had an adverse effect on them as they became professional educators or nurses. And through this project, we brought in people from the community to help train them to go in and conduct research. Then we reported back to the community as a radio program. So we broadcast back to the community what the results of the surveys were. Everything that we did with this project was material for the radio program because that was our goal. We got the money to educate the community through a radio program. We went out and did point of sale observations. We compared A&T's campus community to UNCG. These are two state-supported universities. A&T is historically black. UNCG is historically white. One of the things that really stood out was the advertising. From one mile from our entrance to our campus out, there were 40 professional signs advertising tobacco products. UNCG's campus, there were two. There were no loose cigarettes in UNCG's, sold in UNCG's community. There were frequently, you would go in and you could go in and probably expect to find cigarettes. There were a lot of disparities. And these things made our students more interested in working on the project and recruiting other students. This is a list of, again, we had 10 radio programs that we produced live weekly. This was live call-in show, 30 minutes. In developing the project, again, the goal was to develop leaders so the students would lead the project. You know, oftentimes we do things, again, they're time limited. It's because my goal could be bring the money in, make sure that faculty can have opportunities to research, publish, and that's the end of it. The dean of the School of Education decided this was not what she wanted done with this project. We have responsibility to the community, and we wanted to develop students. So the project, after the money is over, the students would have put things in place with their peers, so it will continue. These students presented at national camp, national conferences, state conferences, and developed projects and initiatives so they can continue to present on our campus. I took the students to Indiana to the Bacchus and Gamma Young Adult Conference. Three of the students had never flown before. We were developing leaders. We were developing students for the future. How do we motivate the students? There were added value experiences. They participated in things that they would not have had an opportunity to do if it wasn't for this tobacco project. They were recognized by the deans and department chairs at sophomore and junior year. A lot of them did not have those relationships or experience. They represented the university, and they gained knowledge of the history and the disparities in the African-American community. We gave them the Willie Lynch, The Making of a Slave, had them to read it, come back, talk about. You know, a lot of our students have gone through school, and they do not know some of the history that impacts how things, policies are made and other things happen in the community. And we had a grand finale when we were ending our project. We invited all our campus partners to come with us to produce a campus community health and wellness festival. Through this festival, we engaged new partners who are going to help us to continue the project. The new partners, which I am pleased to say, we brought on another dean, we brought on a student health center, and we brought in adult education. One of the partners, our lieutenant governor and our state legislator, were on hand to launch a statewide quit line at our festival. And outcomes, what did we do? We put a lot of work into, first, how do we engage the community? How do we develop community? But first and foremost, how do we develop students? How do we develop students so they will take this on as their issue? And it is just, it's not just something that they're going to do for a grade. Students came on Saturdays from 3 to 7 hours a week and worked on this project. They only got a grade one semester. For the next two semesters, they came because they wanted to come. They produced the radio show. 12 students can now use SPSS. We have received a 2-year grant from the Health and Wellness Trust Fund to work on policy. We've received a grant, a 1-year grant from the Congressional Black Caucus Foundation to develop an internet-based cessation program. I have been asking one of my students to serve on the HBCU Project Advisory Committee for the American Red Cross, and we have decided to continue our weekly education radio program and expand it from being about tobacco to about health, health disparities. We've done shows on prostate cancer, on women's health, mental health, HIV and AIDS, and we will start off on hepatitis C in September. So we took a seed, we planted it, and we have a tree with many branches that are working to prevent smoking and tobacco uses on our campus. I hope to come back and report to you that we've changed policies. To date, our policy is in the student handbook. It says, if you smoke, our university will accommodate you smoking in the residence hall by either putting you in a room with a smoker or to have a place available for you to smoke. It will be a new day. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'd like to thank our hosts, particularly the dean at Morgan State University School of Public Health and Policy, and I'd like to thank you all for participating in this important conference, as well as our broader audience who's participating. My task is to sum up these wonderful presentations and to bring you some observations, I suppose, about the foundation's perspective on this particular project. As a representative of the American Legacy Foundation, I take credit for all of their great work. but actually, it's been a collaborative project, and it's one in which we're very proud of the work that they've accomplished, but it's one of many programs that we fund at the American Legacy Foundation through our Priority Populations Department. It's been a vision of my president, Cheryl Hilton, as well as a former board member, Alma Adams, who is indeed from North Carolina, who together kind of envisioned the kind of work that we could do in priority populations. And that's the department at the foundation that addresses health disparities and attempts to spearhead the foundation's efforts in the area of social justice and integrating themes of social justice throughout all of the programs and services and marketing that we undertake at the Legacy Foundation. As you can see, our mission is to build a world where young people reject tobacco and anyone can quit. And since I work in the area of health disparities, that word anyone is really precious and important because my department addresses health disparities across ethnic and racial groups and other underserved populations, including gay, lesbian populations and low-income populations that have been disproportionately impacted by tobacco marketing and has greater health impact as a result of tobacco use. And so it's a really important effort across the board at the Legacy Foundation, but we're particularly proud of the work of the on-the-ground project in North Carolina. So what I'd like to do is to refresh your memory and recap some of the key points from today's presentations, but also just to add a few general observations. Well, as was mentioned, this project engages students in learning about research and encourages them to take leadership roles and to prevent tobacco use. And it's a multi-campus collaboration. And I'll get to the project description in just a moment that will include, there are other partners in this endeavor, but the multi-campuses include Bennett College for Women, North Carolina A&T, North Carolina Central University in Durham. And as you heard a wonderful presentation from Sharon Height about the Sister Chat program from at Bennett College for Women. And we really could relate to that. And at the Legacy Foundation, we have a program called Circle of Friends. And in fact, if you can see this little pin, this symbolizes the Circle of Friends initiative at the foundation. And it's built on the theme of women helping women, women supporting women. And true to that theme, the Sister Chat program has tailored that notion and made it culturally tailored, culturally appropriate for Black women. It is particularly empowering because it started as conversations among women on the campus, but also engaged women in the larger community and then expanded even further among women in the public health community. So we're particularly impressed by the work of Bennett, and they, as was mentioned, had a guest speaker, Jocelyn Elders, who is an outstanding spokesperson, as you well know, who visited the Sister Chat conference that they had a few months ago and had a really inspiring message, one of social empowerment, empowerment that starts from the individual level and expands outward to community responsibility and community empowerment. I was, as was mentioned by the dean earlier, the social responsibility for these young women and young college students goes beyond their individual lives, but they must be cognizant of their roles as future leaders in the Black community, as ones who will be listened to and will be decision makers as well as leaders in the Black community. We'll also discuss with the Point of Sale Project, which had amazing results for a very simple research design, simple in a good, elegant sense of simple. It's observational research in which students were trained on how to make observations in a low-wealth community versus a non-low-wealth or middle-class community to examine the patterns of tobacco advertising and marketing in those communities. And they made really astute observational notes and took the research a step further, as was noted, and their role was not to detect enforcement flaws, but rather to just test the limits and say, well, can our students even go and buy loose cigarettes in these stores? So they looked at advertising as well as sale patterns in low-wealth versus high-wealth communities. They took photos and used other technology to examine the ways in which industry marketing and advertising practices differed in the various communities. The overarching goals of the On the Ground Smoking Cessation Project are threefold. One was to reduce smoking among college students on these campuses, but also to strengthen campus smoking policies, and finally to raise public awareness in surrounding communities. And their mission, or another way of stating the goals, was that the initiative sought to engage college students to serve as effective communicators on these issues and work with faculty and local leaders to develop resources to help reduce and prevent tobacco use in these surrounding communities. And there was quite a process of buy-in, as was discussed by North Carolina A&T. The project components. I think this project is uniquely designed. Our lead organization is North Carolina Institute of Minority Economic Development. They provide North Carolina in general assistance, technical assistance with business development, business management, and oversight. And we are one of their nonprofit entities. They took on this project, and one that has, they have really been a fulcrum, a way in which this project has been effectively administered. So they are the fiscal agent. They receive the legacy grant and issue or redistribute to the partnering colleges. They take a lot of work, overhead work from us in terms of ensuring that all the pieces are in place and ensuring that the administrative needs and fiscal needs of the projects are well met. They have also been effective with aiding program evaluation. I'll talk a little bit later about capacity building, but one of the important contributions, not only from the Institute, but I think an interesting aspect of this program is that the Legacy Foundation provides funding for the evaluation component. And that's an important aspect because many times you need to be able to show impact, show outcomes through a rigorous evaluation. And the Institute for Minority Economic Development has been a real partner in that undertaking. They've also been effective in enhancing sustainability. And then let me tell you a little bit more about the other projects that have presented here today. Bennett College for Women, to recap, has a really strong peer health advocacy program. They are the first ever sister chat program, even though they build it on an evidence-based model. Peer-to-peer support and education has been deemed culturally appropriate, not only from African-American women, but other ethnic and racial groups of women as well. But this is a one-of-a-kind type project. They've effectively developed a community-based research project in which they identify targeted marketing practices by neighborhood. And then an unintended benefit of their program has been to develop a smoke-free campus. That was not part of the funding requirement, but Dr. Cole, being the head of Bennett, a private college for women, being a leader in her field more broadly, determined that the school would walk the walk. And that means that if they're going to undertake this program, then they needed to ensure that the campus was totally smoke-free. And that's a very different experience than was described by Adrienne that occurred at North Carolina A&T University. So these schools have a very different set of challenges, different structures, different manners in which buy-in has to be achieved. One of the stronger aspects of North Carolina A&T University's program is their student researcher and advocacy training program. Adrienne has been a real mentor, a real teacher in the pure sense of the word, in the way in which she has led her students and carefully nurtured them to become spokespersons and student researchers. The radio broadcast program is just fabulous. It's professionally done. Students lead the program and develop the programming for the radio station, but it's been has had excellent reviews. They interview, as she said, in a 10-week series, health professionals, public health professionals, on a tobacco-related topic each week. It's listened to not only by the campus community, but by the community at large, the larger campus, excuse me, beyond the campus, the local community. So it's a service to the community as well as a way to develop expertise among students and to engage public health professionals. North Carolina Central University has taken charge of a multi-site survey and research project, as we heard from Michelle Cotton-Laws. They have a web-based survey, but I think they're particularly well-known for the multi-campus survey that they conducted, a very finely done, rigorous survey. And it's just a wonderful example of an HBCU defining the research agenda. They also have implemented a tobacco policy course. A way of building expertise among students, undergraduates in this case. And they were able to effectively develop smoke-free dormitories. Again, we didn't give them money for that, but we are pleased to see that there is these unintended benefits in which not only does the funding pay for programming, but it also causes the institution to re-examine its policies and the message that it sends through its policies. So we're very impressed with the systems level changes that have occurred at these institutions. I'd like to recap some of the findings from Michelle's wonderful work. So the next few slides, I'd like to just restate some of the points that she brought out to kind of since she spoke first, just kind of refresh your mind and have your pads ready to ask questions and give comments. Michelle gave background first on some of the national findings. For example, she reported from Legacy's fact sheet as well as other sources in the literature that college student tobacco use ranges from about 27 to 34%. And that 10 to 20% of college students initiate smoking or become regular smokers while they're in college. In 2004, African Americans made up about 12% of the college student population at four-year institutions. And it was, as was pointed out by Dr. Noonan, the students, African-American students, tend to begin smoking later, even as they are in college. So that it may be a particularly important time to develop interventions or to further examine this in longitudinal studies to better understand the progression of risk-taking behavior among African-American college students. The importance of the work that is taking place at North Carolina Central University has to do with an HBCU setting the research agenda. As was pointed out, prior research has been mainly conducted in non-minority college settings. A lot of the literature review that we did for this particular conference had to do with mainstream or non-minority college settings, in which we had to kind of couldn't exactly extrapolate or generalize, but we had to use that as a starting point to try to better understand what the patterns are in college settings. There is minimal evidence to support the considerations of cultural competency in prior research findings. I think that was an important observation by Ms. Cotton Laws, that that cultural competency, the support for that, is not well documented in the research literature, and that little is known about the prevalence and social norms and patterns of smoking among students attending HBCUs. Her research showed some interesting findings related to social norms, that the majority of students responded that smoking was discouraged among their peers. Less than approximately 9% of smokers reported that they prefer associating with peers who smoke compared to less than 1% of non-smokers. Okay, so we know that people of like minds, like tendencies, tend to hang together. But I think it's important data documenting these patterns of social norms. So about 14% of current smokers compared to about 44% of non-smokers reported that none of their closest friends smoke. Her research bore out important differences by race. African Americans, for example, about 26% said they liked the sensation that they get, compared to whites and others who for whom the majority, about 41%, says it's a habit that I can't control. And since the idea of sensation seeking is a little bit less important in terms of the percentage of white students who indicated that that's their primary reason for smoking. The important element about the project at Central University and other similar programs is the research capacity building, as I mentioned, and that in the past 12 months, for example, the most common ways students sought help for quitting were as follows. They sought information from websites or web-based programs, about 14%. Some of them attended health education programs in school, and some of them used medicine to help smoking, about 10%. The interesting overlay, the contrast, is the public health service guidelines, in which best practices are beginning to be very well defined and very well documented, that the use of nicotine replacement therapies have been shown to boost the likelihood that one would quit smoking. And yet we see that in this population, less than 10% consider it an effective option. We also know that the use of quit lines is highly recommended, and we also know that increasingly web-based interventions will be an important best practice for smoking cessation. So we see from this data that we have our work cut out if, in fact, only 14% of students use web-based resources and less than 10% use nicotine replacement therapies. The leading reasons given by smokers for not being able to smoke: strong cravings, approximately 44%. Unrelated to this research, we've seen some research that shows that African Americans tend to use mentholated cigarettes much more compared to non-minority or other populations. So cravings, the smoothness of the cigarette, and how it's perceived or felt, the sensation, may be an important avenue for research in the future. The other reasons for not being able to stop smoking include feelings of irritability. And again, there are medications that can kind of take that edge off and that would aid the cessation attempt among smokers. As was also pointed out earlier, African American students and people in general start smoking later. However, they have the toughest time trying to quit smoking. So they catch up with whites and others as adults, and in fact, the health impact is far greater as they move into adulthood. So these findings are important because they give us a window into appreciating and understanding what are some of the barriers that people experience as they try to quit smoking, and are they using these effective interventions that we know have begun to be very effective. The cessation programs, are they perceived as beneficial to African-American students? Many say that self-help measures are useful. Peer support, again, is somewhat useful, and school-based programs. So those were some of the findings that I recap from the North Carolina Central University and Michelle Cotton Law's presentation. All of the presentations were really excellent, gave us great insights, but I also just want to make a few statements about the North Carolina A&T program as well. We learned that from Adrienne's program that her strong effort has been in the area of developing student advocates, and her three main objectives for her program were as follows: student recruiting, training, and motivation. She was very effective in engaging the campus as well, the campus community as well as the larger surrounding community. And that I believe one of her major challenges, as she described her program, has been achieving buy-in among faculty and administrators. She talked about recruiting and that she had to answer the question, what's in it for me? And she had to answer that question for administrators, faculty, as well as students, so that she was very effective in describing what she can offer to faculty, students, for example, service learning hours, the multidisciplinary partnerships, good public relations, potential for additional grant support, and for students, of course, the academic incentives and other incentives for participating in this program. Wonderful. Examples were given of the student research project, the storefront data collection that took place at A&T compared to UNC Greensboro, and the number of signs and the placement of signs, the sale of Lucy's, the sale of designer cigars, the visibility of these signs in the local community. And most effective was their radio program that you described, the Listen Up program, and the speakers, the caliber of speakers that she had on a weekly radio program, and talking about all of the tobacco-related topics and the impact on the local community. The projects engaged both campus and community. They involved research training, the student-led radio program, educational programs and presentations, and importantly, community involvement. They examined issues that were of importance to the entire community. Most importantly, they were culturally tailored, culturally appropriate, informational messages that resonated with local residents, with members of the local community. So just in summary, a few points I'd like to make. North Carolina has been a fertile ground for establishing this type of intervention with 11 historically black colleges and universities. I believe it holds a record in terms of HBCUs in a state. And it has that distinction and a long history. The on-the-ground project represents an opportunity, a unique opportunity, to serve a population that has often been overlooked in tobacco control and in most challenging circumstances and settings. An important outcome of this project has been the synergy and sustainability. This project created an opportunity to enhance the collaboration of a multi-campus collaboration of North Carolina colleges. They also developed a potential model. They showcased a model for future partnerships, and many aspects are potentially replicable. They were successful in securing additional grant funds from the North Carolina Department of Health and Health Trust Fund and from other sources of funding. An important impact of this project has been in the area of capacity building. Through this project, we've enhanced the role of HBCUs in the tobacco control movement. This project has been successful in training and developing student leaders. It has successfully enhanced research capacity and it has provided tools for program evaluation. I'd like to just let you know what our next phase of priority populations is. As I mentioned in the beginning, this is the Priority Populations Initiative is a cornerstone of the American Legacy Foundation's efforts to address disparities, and not only at HBCUs, but broadly. We work with community-based organizations throughout the nation. We work with health departments and other in universities. We have other types of model partnerships that have been effective. But we like this program. It's been one that we have learned a lot of lessons from, one that we promote in advance. And we feel that it's one that works in a very important community, one that not only because of the African Americans that reside there and low-income populations, but also the context in which they work is key. The Priority Populations Phase 2 will include funding to expand key aspects of the current HBCU initiative. So we won't fund another comprehensive program like this, but we will fund projects that that replicate some aspect or some component of the programs that you've heard about here today. Minority-serving educational institutions will be invited to submit a funding application later this year. We expect that information will be available at the American Legacy website. As you see there, it's americanlegacy.org. We'll have information about the funding initiative itself around September of this year, 2006. But more broadly, if you want to learn about any of the programs, the health disparities programming, our marketing and outreach programs, if you want to learn about the technical assistance or about Circle of Friends and the many fine programs of the American Legacy Foundation, I invite you to our website, which you see there. So thank you for your attention.
As those of you who know me know, I always have questions, but I understand that the email question has beaten me to the punch. So we have, I'm jumped ahead. I want to tell our audience that if you want to send in a question, you can send it to questions@unc.edu. I have just lost the telephone number, but I'm sure it is going across the screen. And if you're in the audience and would like to ask a question, we have a microphone on either side of the auditorium. And that number is 1-877-869-7811. Now we have a question from email.
Yes, our first question is from Lango Dean at the Career Communications Group here in Baltimore, Maryland. Research says young women who smoke tobacco have their first cigarette in their tweens or early teens, so that by the time they get to college, they have already formed a habit. How do you plan on reaching young girls in middle and high school?
Ms. Laws, would you start off on that with the data part of it at least?
Sure. Actually, what we found was that the males were the ones that were of particular interest in our findings in terms of smoking, but the current and previous research literature certainly does support that fact that was expressed by the emailer. I would recommend, I think a lot of work, substantial work has been done already to address smoking and tobacco use among K through 12 populations. And I would recommend that we take a closer look at some of those programs that have been implemented at the elementary and junior high and middle school levels and begin to do what we did, and that is evaluate their efficacy, disaggregating the data. So not only by gender, but also by race and ethnicity. And use that to inform the future development of other prevention and cessation programs. So again, go back, take a closer look. A lot of the research was grounded that we've done in the adult population actually was grounded in what we know in that among that population. So take another look and allow the research to inform, but certainly look at some of the cessation and prevention programs that have proven effective over the years, and there's certainly enough evidence out there.
Dr. Lettlow?
I thank the emailer for that question, because indeed young women are at risk, particularly young women who are in college. They smoke at the college level, they smoke at comparable rates to young men in college. One of the effective ways that students, not only students, but young women can receive important educational messages is through mass media campaigns. Many of you may be familiar with Legacy's Truth campaign, and that campaign is a national campaign in which it's addressed to risk-taking, open-to-smoking youth. And so that, coupled with comprehensive programs that will assist people who are attempting to quit smoking, we find has been effective. In fact, we're beginning to see the impact and results from the Truth campaign to show that there is a decline that is attributable to Truth campaign marketing, so that we feel that if young people receive the message that they are the potential future audience or potential customers for tobacco companies, that they will use that knowledge as a tool to resist the uptake of tobacco use. So we believe that the campaign, coupled with usable web-based programs or quit lines, will support those young women who are experimenting with tobacco use.
Anyone else? Okay, we have another question via email.
Yes, from Wanda Richards in Atlanta, Georgia. Is the prevalence of smoking among blacks on HBCUs comparable to the prevalence of smoking among blacks on non-HBCU campuses? If they aren't, then why do you suspect that there is a difference?
And that is one of the questions that we're continuing to look for, because there was a dearth of information in the research literature. But we do know that what informed us was what we were finding in the general college population, and that was that the rate was comparably lower than that of the white students in majority colleges settings, college and university settings. So to answer the second one, I don't have an answer to that. The answer is I don't know, or don't have an answer in terms of why we think there would be differences. I think we can go back to some of the affective, psychosocial, depressive stuff, some of the things that we were finding, not in some ways serendipitously to the hypotheses that we had already, that we had formed to guide our research. And so we're taking a further look at that, and what we are interested in doing is administering our survey at one of the state supported institutions, possibly, I don't know, I haven't spoken with anyone in my department about this, but maybe at North Carolina State University or a UNC Chapel Hill to see if indeed there are significant differences.
To add that, that's a wonderful research question, the differences, but there may be some differences. One of the aspects of that may be researchable would be social support that African-American students may or may not have at the HBCU campus versus a majority white campus. So I think that Michelle has some interesting preliminary data that shows aspects of social norms and the importance and value of social support in either the uptake or maintenance of tobacco use. So that may be a new area of exploration, the normative effects, the need for social support among these students, and what unique pressures are some of these students under, if they're, for example, the first in their family to go to college. What are some of the unique pressures that these students face that would encourage them to smoke?
We have a caller from Missouri whose question we should be able to hear. Go ahead, caller.
Yes, my name is Gwendolyn Randall. I'm calling from Sackman Cancer Center, which is affiliated with Washington University. And I guess this question would be more directed to Michelle Cotton Laws, where she talked about the depression factor and some of the peer groups. And I have an interest from a research aspect if at any point the lesbian, gay, bisexual, transsexual community was looked at in their smoking habits, because oftentimes tobacco has been used to entice them or glamorize the use of tobacco as a means of being inclusive with a group that's already ostracized.
Very, very interesting and intriguing question in terms of my research interest. I did not look at sexual orientation as a category, but certainly would be interested in speaking with you further. If you would email me at malaws@ncsu.edu. That's malaws@ncsu.edu. I'd like to explore some opportunities that maybe you and I could work on together in looking at that particular population. I have not at all to date.
I certainly will.
Excuse me?
Thank you very much.
Anyone else? Okay, can I get a question in as the moderator? I have so many. You've talked about smoke-free campuses, and I think we've heard two different scenarios, one successful, one not yet successful. Can each of you, Ms. Height and Ms. Witherspoon, talk about the resistances you met in developing a smoke-free campus, and in the case where we don't have a success yet, what actions need to be taken in order to bring about a smoke-free campus? Ms. Heifer?
Okay. Again, as I said in my presentation, with Bennett College being a private, historically black college located in Greensboro, North Carolina, with Dr. Cole, our 14th president, simply making the statement that the college was going to go 100% smoke-free, tobacco-free, that was basically it. There was a meeting with the Board of Trustees, as well as members of the senior staff, which consisted of the executive vice president and different vice presidents, basically saying that they wanted to actively support the American Legacies Foundation's mission, which was to create a world when young people reject tobacco and anyone can quit. But again, Dr. Cole, being the president of the college, she gave the charge again that you cannot lead where you will not go. So with us receiving the funds from American Legacy Foundation, she, along with members of the senior staff and board of trustee members, felt that it would be almost hypocritical to accept funds from the American Legacy Foundation without taking an active support or role in the college going smoke-free. So it wasn't like there was a process. What did you do and so forth?
We heard that. What happened to the people who smoked?
The people who smoked had to walk off campus to smoke. There was no areas. There was not a time in which you say, okay, effective so-and-so date, we're going smoke-free. The only date that was given, I think it was maybe 30 days, a 30-day notice. Effective July 1, we're smoke-free. If anyone is seen on campus smoking, immediately you will be asked to leave by public safety. So it was pretty cut and dry.
And did this really cause people to stop smoking completely?
It caused them to stop smoking on Bennett's campus. Now, did it cause them to stop smoking? That's a good question. We will not see or have not seen students or faculty staff members smoke on campus. However, I have been approached by faculty members who have said that this is somewhat difficult. They will leave campus, go into their cars, and drop off campus to go smoke. And again, we have programs, Cessation, mechanisms in place with the Student Health Center. So it was kind of difficult. I would be dishonest if I made the statement that it was just easy to go smoke-free and that there was no problem, everything was perfect. That would be dishonest and misleading. However, again, with the rule, the law saying that we're smoke-free, it kind of gave, it kind of put those who were smoking in a delicate situation, because again, you will be asked to leave. And if you're a faculty member, this is where you teach and you instruct the students, then it will put you in a delicate situation. But again, it was not so much of a process. It was just effective so-and-so day that we are a smoke-free campus. Hopefully that answered your question.
Yes, thanks.
Okay,
Ms. Witherspoon?
Well, when we received this money, tobacco prevention was not a priority on our campus. And to my knowledge, there was not research by faculty to work toward a prevention program. And approaching it from a social justice perspective, and at the moment, I'm the driving force behind it. My approach, with the endorsement of the two deans that I've worked with and with the department chair, was to educate, to develop resources, to develop student understanding of the importance of this with community support, and at that point, let students, and we do have a history of activism, have students to help drive this for policy change. We understand that it is a habit, it is an addiction, that it is the result of targeting for many years. My dad died of emphysema. He smoked in World War II with his allocation of cigarettes. You know, he was smoking the day that he died. We understand that as an addiction. And so in my capacity as project director, we are approaching it with a parallel strategies to provide support. We've done the education program, which we will continue to provide cessation and prevention support while we're working on trying to develop policy changes. And we don't know what those policy changes will look like now. One of our grants is dictating that we approach it one way. We are working with that to say what is best for our community, through our community.
Thank you very much. We have an email question coming up next.
Yes, from Takesha Powell in Baltimore. Her question is, in the studies you have reported, have you examined these prevalences amongst different groups of blacks? So African Americans versus black Hispanics versus African students.
Yes, in our sample, there was such a small number of, they were given an opportunity. We used basically the same race and ethnicity category that is used in the U.S. Census. So they could identify themselves as Latino, black, and, we also had African from the continent, Caribbean, and so forth. And the percentage of students who identify themselves as such, as opposed to one of the African American white categories or Hispanic, was very small. So that's where that 14% of other, it includes students who were identified as African from the continent, African, and so those differences are reported accordingly to that category.
Okay. At this microphone, please introduce yourself and address your question.
I'm Mildred Yarborough from Coppin State University here in Baltimore, Maryland. And my question is to Ms. Witherspoon. From a social justice standpoint, with your state being a tobacco producing state, I think of the income producing problem that's created by cessation of smoking. Has the state health department or the university taking on the role of retraining those people who may be losing jobs because of the decrease in tobacco production? And also, is the agricultural department in your state looking at research in the use of tobacco for other products other than smoking?
I am pleased to say North Carolina is. As I said, Legacy was one pot of tobacco settlement money that came into our state, but there are two other pots in the state that came through the legislature. We have two more foundations. One is the Golden Leaf Foundation that works in the tobacco producing communities on economic development initiatives. And the other is the Health and Wellness Trust Fund, which gives money to work toward health-related issues. Our School of Agriculture is working through a grant from the Golden Leaf Foundation to help farmers with alternative crops. One large initiative now is mushrooms. Tobacco farmers are producing commercial mushrooms. And through the Golden Leaf Foundation, there are a number of our institutions, including North Carolina A&T, Winston-Salem State University, I think East Carolina University, that are developing initiatives to train people who have traditionally generated their incomes from the tobacco industry, whether it was production or manufacturing, so they have marketable skills.
Okay, we have many questions coming in. We have a phone call from Florida.
Hi, this is Tracy from Florida.
Hello.
And my question is, now that you've done some of the things with the stores and everything like that, how are you planning to, in the future, engage store owners to help fight the tobacco problems in your communities?
I would like to answer that. This is Adrienne Witherspoon. Our next step with our students is for them to collaborate with communities. That's why we work with the communities. The educating is to say, let's look at the disparities. Look at what happens in your community. What is the norm? Why is it normal for us to walk down your community and see all of these advertisements? And develop a strategy together to ask the merchants to take our interests at heart, and to change the way they are promoting cigarettes in our community. I don't know what would happen. We're looking for research now to see who's done that, see are there any successes, but our next step is to partner with the community. Again, to mobilize interests from campus and community to engage in conversations to see if we can change it. I don't know where it would go. I don't know. Do you know of any models or anything that's been done on this? Is the speaker from Florida
there? From Florida? She must have hung up.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. We have more questions, and I have more, but I'll ask the speaker at the microphone on the right to give us some glorious words.
Sure. Pamela Scott Johnson, Morgan State University, Department of Psychology, Baltimore, Maryland. My question is related to the data you presented that suggested that 9 to 12% of the students or the sample started smoking in college and actually continued their smoking into adulthood. And I'd like for anybody on the panel to talk about the addictive nature or what's known about the predisposition or some biological marker that would have these individuals develop a kind of an addiction and not be able to quit smoking as compared to people who start earlier and who have a higher probability of quitting.
Okay, there's mixed evidence about predisposition. There are people who can become addicted more rapidly than others. But smoking tobacco is an addictive product, that we do know. And the more you smoke, the more likely you are to become addicted. But one of the things that we talked about earlier is that African-American young people smoke fewer cigarettes per day than white young people. But then why is it so hard for African Americans to quit? I think there are a lot of questions to be asked and to need to be answered here. Does anybody at the panel have anything they want to add here?
I don't want to add anything other than in looking at some of the research on the correlation between depression, there's some research that Hannah, I think it's Shahi and DeFore published around the early onset of regular smoking to alcohol use, depression, illicit drug use, and other risky behaviors. And there's some data in there, or some findings that were published in their article that looks at some of the characteristics of those students who, or those persons who, in which the early onset of regular tobacco use was predictive of lifetime drug use and depressive disorders, and they found that it was as predictive as early onset of alcohol use. And I can share that specifically with you along with their list of cited references, because in that there are some references that may lead you in the right direction, if you like. So if you'll stick around, I'll share that.
I'd like to just add something to that.
Yes, go ahead.
Okay. I would agree with Michelle that in some cases it may be underlying factors such as untreated depression, but there are also other comorbidities such as use of alcohol or other substance abuse that has been shown to be strongly linked with tobacco use. And so that there may be some prevalence issues that need further examination about the co-occurring use of tobacco as well as substance use and/or alcohol, and to look at many of the mental health issues that have been strongly associated with tobacco use. I would also suggest that there may be some differences in quitting patterns among African Americans that may be related to targeted marketing, tobacco company marketing of specific population groups, and examine the impact on quitting behavior in relation to marketing. Tobacco companies probably have the best data in that regard because they spend billions of dollars in promoting their products, and so they probably would be the best source of information about the impact on quitting behavior. So I'm not sure it's well known in the public health community. Finally, I would like to offer that it may quitting behavior may be strongly associated with tobacco policies. A best practice has been shown that certain tobacco-related policies have an impact on prevalence rates, smoking rates. States such as California and Massachusetts are really instructive in terms of how strong, comprehensive tobacco policies can directly impact smoking rates. So policies such as clean indoor air ordinances have been shown to have an impact, reducing access to tobacco products by youth, and of course, increasing excise tax on cigarettes has a strong direct impact on smoking uptake by youth and by poor people. So policies may be another consideration.
Thank you, Dr. Lettlow. We have a call from Missouri, another call from Missouri. Go ahead, caller.
Hi, my name is Talitha McHenry. I work for a program initiative of Washington University that's focused on health disparities. And earlier, Michelle Laws spoke a little bit about their program, I believe, and she talked about the ways that students seek for quitting smoking. And I'm curious to know what the success rate was for those who, you know, actually used the helpline or, you know, that basically worked and wanted to quit smoking.
We did not measure that. We specifically asked what programs they considered of those students who were smokers who had sought help. What programs did they consider were beneficial? And also we asked a question with regards to over the past 12 months, in what ways did you seek help? And so that is certainly, in terms of future research, something that we would want to look at. But I think when you look at individual cessation efforts or programs, there's information out there. For example, Dr. Lettlow talked about best practices, and so we do know that some of the programs are or cessation efforts are listed as best, that have been listed as best practices are in the research arena, it's sort of common knowledge now. We know that quit lines are certainly heralded as one that is cost effective as well as effective, although it was not one of the ones that was listed or ranked highly among our population. So we did not measure that as the short of that. We specifically wanted to know what they considered were effective, and that was it.
Okay, the people in the booth are really getting to us here. 10 seconds each for last remarks. But let us remember that the Surgeon General had a report out yesterday about indoor air that said you could not have a smoking area over there and a smoke-free area over here. In your last remarks, would you talk about what you want to talk about, but also indicate how that impacts what you're trying to do?
Right on, Surgeon General. Now, my comment, no. What I want to talk about. While there's common interest in better understanding the impact of tobacco use and interventions, we must recognize that there are different stakeholders that have different interests. Basically, what I'm saying is we have to understand that within the minority populations, it is important for us to recognize that we must begin to look at the research agenda as it fits those populations and not necessarily one that has been commonly used or widely practiced. There are other things that I think I could go further and elaborate on, and particularly this co-occurring issue that continues to come up. So I will just say there's a lot more research that needs to be done that in research by researchers who set the research agenda around the needs, interests, and unique cultural characteristics and experiences of minority population. There's so much more work in terms of empirical findings and research that we need to do. And so I ask and encourage people of non-minority serving populations to look at historically Black colleges and universities to help them conduct research and also to lead some of the research efforts around this issue.
We're getting the cutoff sign, so I hope that you'll continue this important discussion with your colleagues, associates, and representatives. And I'd like to thank all of the people whom I was going to name for their role in putting this event on. And we need to continue to remember that smoking is the number one cause of preventable death in this country, number one public health issue. We have to keep the battle going. Thank you very much.